For 6 years, the University of Maryland's business school has been sending its MBA students to prison for a scared straight field trip in white-collar crime. Suppose your boss asks, can't you fudge the financials?
Can't you pick up $1 million so we can do this? And your answer should be, unequivocally, absolutely, no.
Just say no, advises former developer Daniel Colton, or you may wind up like him, serving a 3-year sentence for conspiracy. His audience, students just days away from entering a business world where morals may be looser than ever.
The big joke is that business ethics is an oxymoron, i.e., you can't simply talk about ethics when you're talking about business. There are none.
Barbara Toffler is a professor of business ethics and thus thinks it isn't a contradiction in terms, though she admits stock scams like the ones that have made Enron a household name are as old as the market itself. Consider this poem. Some in clandestine companies combine, erect new stocks to trade beyond the line, with air and empty names beguile the town, and raise new credits first, then cry 'em down, divide the empty nothing into shares, and set the crowd together by the ears. That's Daniel Defoe of Robinson Crusoe fame, writing in the early 1700s. Here's the French artist Daumier in the mid-1800s, depicting a speculator in the stock market planting false rumors to manipulate prices. And we're all old enough to remember the insider trading and junk bond scandals of the late 1900s, starring Ivan Boesky, Mike Milken, and the like. But Barbara Toffler thinks ethics now are actually worse than ever. At least in the 1980s, she says.
It was a big boys' game. And in fact, much of the history of unethical behavior, if you will, in business has been kind of a big boys' game.
So in a sense, it was them against themselves.
Exactly. And obviously, stock prices were affected. Obviously, the stock market was affected. Obviously, the institutional and the individual investor were affected. But we did not have the kind of impact on you and me and the general population that we now do.
Where more vulnerable investors are the ones getting disproportionately hurt, like the blue-collar phone workers we interviewed recently at Global Crossing. The modern business ethics industry was born in the late 70s, part of the post-Watergate reform movement. Business ethics became so hot, a firm like Arthur Andersen, yes, that Arthur Andersen, spent millions to be identified with the topic, making and distributing videotapes to explain why morality was vital to U.S. corporate success. Here's one of their stars, Stu Leonard Sr., CEO of a discount dairy chain.
The most important single fundamental thing of success in business is to build your house on a solid foundation of integrity, of a solid foundation of ethics.
One hint that things were getting worse, though Andersen hired Barbara Toffler in 1995, it was to help them make money, not clean up their act.
They hired me to sell services to clients. They didn't hire me to do work with them internally.
Oh, you were going to sell?
I was hired to set up a consulting practice in ethics and responsible business practices. I was not hired to do internal work at Arthur Andersen.
Did you ever expect that Arthur Andersen's internal culture would be at odds with what you were trying to teach?
I learned that as I was trying to sell services and found people asking me if Arthur Andersen was doing internally those things that I was trying to sell to them. And they weren't.
Meanwhile, the ethics of Arthur Andersen, once the purest of pure auditors, sank to new lows. Why? Well, perhaps we should use the famous words of Watergate, follow the money. Or as white-collar criminal Daniel Colton puts it,
money is the hugest intoxicant there is.
Barbara Toffler says that intoxicant became the drink of choice, even for the top accounting firms.
Everybody was making money. They were jumping on the bandwagon. They forgot what they were supposed to be doing. They forgot that they were watchdogs. They forgot they were protectors of the investor. And they became hotshot firms. You know, we're a big name. We can play with the big boys and we can make big money. And they did start making big money. So they too were seduced. I'll be honest with you. I stayed at Arthur Andersen probably longer than I would have because I liked the money that I was making.
By the late 90s, Andersen's ethics consulting had petered out for lack of clients. And Andersen's ethics tapes, despite their lofty ambitions and earnest host, don't seem to have had much impact.
Over the years, our family, our religion, our community and schools have helped to shape our values. Thou shalt not steal.
But maybe it's a good thing that these tapes never became bestsellers, seeing as how the one with Stu Leonard might be a better guide to sin than sincerity.
The people that look for the shortcut, the prisons are filled with them.
But just 2 years after this tape was sent to schools all over the country, Stu Leonard Sr. pleaded guilty to skimming $17 million in profits, much of which he carried, the government reported, on tens if not hundreds of trips to St. Martin in the Caribbean, in amounts ranging from $10,000 to upwards of $250,000 in suitcases or even wrapped as baby gifts. It was the largest tax fraud in Connecticut history, and Leonard was sentenced to 52 months in prison. Two brothers-in-law received sentences. Son Stu Jr., the store's president, also admitted involvement, but was granted immunity as part of his dad's plea bargain, which makes the ethical rule of thumb with which this tape ends almost surreal.
Would the boy you were be proud of the man you are? And I would say that the boy I was would be proud of the man I am, and I would wish that on anyone. If my dad, you know, were alive today, he would say, atta boy, Stu.
Today, Leonard is out of jail, and Stu Leonard's chain is expanding. If any stigma remains, it hasn't seemed to hurt business. But the biggest surprise may be that anyone did jail time at all. Because according to Justice Department data, U.S. attorneys prosecuted only 187 defendants over the last decade for white-collar crimes. And while 142 were found guilty, a healthy 76% conviction rate, only 87 did time, usually at a minimum security, so-called club fed. Attorney Jake Szymanski believes lenient sentencing has helped create the current climate.
There needs to be some serious jail time for analysts who are caught committing fraud, CEOs that are looting their companies. Until we send somebody away for a long period of time in a real prison, nothing is going to change.
Now, Szymanski used to represent defendants, penny stock scam artists, like those seen in the film Boiler Room.
Harry, let me close the door to my office. 1 second, all right? I remember you saying something about wanting to buy a house, right?
Yeah.
Well, how'd you like to pay for it tomorrow in cash?
I said I was the devil's advocate. And I was revolted by my clients. I didn't like going to work and doing what I was doing, getting brokerage firms away with murder. And it got to me.
So, in 1998, Szymanski switched sides.
I am now representing public customers in claims against major Wall Street firms like Merrill Lynch and Smith Barney. And unfortunately, I have seen at major Wall Street firms the same type of boiler room tactics that I saw in the 90s at these other firms.
This is a business ethics class for MBA students at Babson College in Wellesley, Massachusetts.
If they're committing fraud, that's a crime, and that's punishable by 5 years, 10 years, 15 years.
If you go and you punish people just because the stock ended up tanking and the market ended up not performing, then you go punishing people for taking risks.
But I think where we get into trouble and firms should pay the price are when there's ulterior motives and there's other funding going on by the companies.
After several hours of heated, knowledgeable debate, I asked whether they would have touted stocks they didn't believe in.
How many would have knuckled under, essentially?
Not a single hand went up. But then one student suggested pushing the hypothetical a bit further.
So if you ask this question again, how many people would put that buy if it got them $20 million in the bank? I think you'd see a lot of hands go up.
$20 million for one buy recommendation. How many people, honestly now? Honest answers.
The class's professor had been there for the vote. The Reverend Tom Sullivan is a Presbyterian minister.
What would Jesus have thought of it?
Jesus would have said, oh, come on, you can't do that, and you know you can't do it.
He would have been a good Jew in saying that. He'd be a good Christian in saying that. He'd be a good Hindu. He'd be a good Buddhist. Nobody who takes any kind of spiritual values seriously is going to say, oh yeah, that's fine.
Indeed, spiritual values may explain the results of one last vote.
How many of you would imagine that your parents think that your generation is less ethical than theirs? Every single one of you?
Now, not everyone thinks we're going to hell in a handbasket. Ed Petrie, who runs the nation's largest group of in-house corporate ethics officers, says that in some areas, ethical standards have improved.
Conflict of interest inside the organization, gifts and gratuities, time charging, sexual harassment issues, diversity issues, vast improvement on those fronts inside the organization.
But nobody was paying much attention to things like corporate governance, reporting your financial statements.
Well, I won't say people weren't paying attention to them, but part of the problem is that the expectations are much higher than they used to be. And you also have far more employees who are willing to come forward with allegations. And you have the public who is looking and eager to hold companies to a higher standard and want them to be accountable.
But is corporate America responding by hiring ethicists like Barbara Toffler?
Do I have a lot of work as a business ethics consultant? No.
Instead, Toffler's writing a book on her years at Arthur Andersen and teaching ethics at Columbia Business School. Easier, perhaps, than teaching them in the real world of recent years, since in economic terms, the bigger the payoffs became for playing fast and loose, the greater the cost of being ethical, in terms of risks not taken, opportunities foregone.
All done, says Boston.
Of course, that's true of any boom, not just this one, suggesting that in the end, business ethics may simply be at one of its cyclical ebbs. But whether we've hit new lows or not, Daniel Colton's words ring equally true.
Please, please, be vigilant, be careful, be honest, be open. Do not expose yourself to these kinds of dangers.
Words easier to say than to live by, it seems, when you get down to business.